Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Western Michigan University's Miller Auditorium. Please turn off all cell phones and pagers or set them to the silent mode. In the unlikely event of an emergency, an alarm will sound and strobe lights will flash. If an emergency occurs, walk, do not run, to the nearest exit. The nearest exit might not be the door through which you entered. Please take a moment now to locate the exit closest to your seat. Thank you for your cooperation.
Good afternoon, and welcome to the Western Michigan University Homer Stryker, MD, School of Medicine Class of 2022 White Coat Ceremony. Please be seated. Out of respect for all guests, we ask that you do not approach a stage to take personal photos throughout processional and ceremony. We have professional photographers and videographers capturing today's event. Thank you for your cooperation. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me, WMed leadership, faculty, and scholar advisors in welcoming the WMed class of 2022. Thank you. Once again, welcome to the Western Michigan University Homer Stryker MD School of Medicine Class of 2022 White Coat Ceremony. I'm Dr. Peter Zimkowski, Associate Dean for Student Affairs. It's my privilege to be your host for today's ceremony. On behalf of Dean Hal Jensen, the Medical School Associate Deans, Assistant Deans, Department Chairs, and faculty, it's my honor to welcome you all and to thank you for joining us today. Also, welcome to everyone out there following the events via live stream. Today's ceremony is all about the white coat, the most iconic symbol of the medical profession. Here to tell you more is Dr. Michael Boucher, Associate Dean for Educational Affairs.
Thank you, Dr. Zimkowski. Hello and welcome, everyone. It's an exciting day. Let us start at the beginning of the white coat tradition. In the middle of the 19th century, the medical profession turned to science to provide breakthrough advances in curing disease. At the time, physicians adopted the scientific lab coat as their standard. Originally, lab coats were beige, but when adopted by the medical profession, white was chosen. The color white, representing purity, is a visual reminder of the physician's commitment to do no harm. The white coat symbolizes seriousness of purpose and is a cloak of compassion. Today, whenever you see the media depict the medical profession, the most common accessory adorning physicians is the white coat. In 1993, Arnold P. Gold Foundation and physicians at the Columbia University College of Physicians and Surgeons initiated the first white coat ceremony. Since that time, it's been adopted by many med schools in the U.S. and abroad. The ceremony was designed to welcome entering medical students and to help them establish a psychological contract for the practice of medicine. The Arnold P. Gold Foundation works with healthcare professionals in training and in practice to instill the values of compassionate, collaborative, scientifically sound caregiving right at the start of training. A lapel pin with the foundation's logo, the Mobius Loop, has been placed on the white coats that the class of 2022 will be cloaked with today. This logo symbolizes the continuous bond of trust, respect, and clear communication between healthcare professionals and their patients. This occurs when humanism is at the core of medical practice. The white coat is one of medicine's most important symbols, signifies, in the words of Dr. Gold, a physician's responsibility not only for the care of patients, but also for the care for patients. To offer greetings from WMed student body, I'd like to introduce Arlene Ho, president of the WMed class of 2021.
Thank you, Dr. Boucher. Happy Saturday, WMed community, family, friends, and supporters. My name is Arlene Ho, and I'm the class president for the second year class here at WMed. I've been asked to share some thoughts from the student perspective, and let me just start with this. There's arguably no one happier to have the class start than the 2021s, because, well, we aren't at the bottom of the food chain anymore. In all seriousness, I'm honored to be standing here speaking to an accomplished, intelligent, and kind group of individuals who no doubt will become amazing physicians. I also want to take this time to acknowledge the support from your loved ones who have been with you through the trials and tribulations, the successes and the celebrations, and are continuing to cheer you on. So, keeping them in mind, or while you try to make eye contact with them in the audience, let's have a round of applause for them. One of the first things that you receive, other than the white coat for today, as a medical student from our lovely benefactors is a stethoscope, or as Gene Shelton likes to call them, doctor necklaces. For those unfamiliar, it's that thing that physicians and other health professionals keep in their pockets or around their necks to hear internal body sounds. The proper word for that in the healthcare field is auscultation. I'm a little bit of a word nerd, so I learned that the etymological origin of auscultation is from the Latin auscultare, which means to listen. For what seems like the entirety of medical school, it'll feel like all you're doing is listening. From listening to mandatory lectures at 8 a.m. about getting enough sleep, to listening about glycolysis and the cell cycle, to finally being in the clinic or the hospital, listening to the clinicians talk to patients while you stand in the corner of the room trying to stay out of the way for an awkwardly long amount of time, trying to the point where your legs are kind of sore but there aren't any extra chairs in the room. I can understand that anxious feeling of wanting to know enough or wanting to prove yourself so that you can finally be heard instead of constantly being the one listening. Everyone has heard the phrase, there's no I in team, and there isn't an I in get the AED or don't drop the baby either. Medicine is very much a collaborative effort to bring forth the best possible care for the patient. There's a reason that the field has shifted to place such a heavy emphasis on patient-centered care. And to me, this makes sense. We exist because there are people who need us. Because of that, I want you all to keep this in your minds. Medicine is not about your ego. It's not about being more right than someone else or trying to show that you know all of the answers because, one, no one has all the answers, and two, more often than not, the answer isn't so clear-cut. In fact, it's the complete opposite. They say your ego quickly gets shattered as you desperately try to drink from the fire hose. I don't know if you're tired of that analogy yet. And what I have seen and learned in the year that I've been here is that the people next to you, in front of you, behind you, your peers, classmates, and family, for the next 4 years, will be your rocks. Experiencing the pains and joys of attaining a medical education is much better with good people around you. And I think that's a big reason why so many of us, well, all of us, chose WMed. However, it is also very true that there are a couple of I's in physician. There will be times when our future jobs will require that we critically apply the knowledge that we've accumulated throughout these next years, and the teams we lead will look to us for guidance. Because of that, we need to put our best foot forward in learning all that we can and improving upon our ability to apply that knowledge in the real world. When you inevitably start feeling overwhelmed by the amount of information that's trying to be stuffed in that 3-pound organ upstairs, remember that perhaps one day, that one detail you decided not to overlook about GLUT1 transporters could save someone's life. Until then, it might feel hard to feel useful as a medical student. However, I read a sentence recently in an article in JAMA that made me think. The most important service we can provide to a patient is often not what we think it is. I believe there's a reason that the stethoscope is such a recognizable symbol for healthcare. It represents the feelings that we had when we decided to pursue this profession. It represents the promise that you will make when you take your oath today to our patients and families, the promise to listen and to heal, both by providing medical advice and by being someone who is trusted enough by people so that they reveal information about themselves that they don't even tell their loved ones. It represents the promise that we will listen to not only the words that are coming out of their mouths, but also to their hearts. To listen in between the lines to their fears, their worries, and uncertainties about their conditions and subsequently their lives. This is something in which medical students have the potential to excel, because as much as we have to learn and do as students, we have the luxury of being granted the most time to spend with and think about each individual patient. Of course, I'd be remiss if I didn't tell the class of 2022 about the fun and give some encouraging words. In the year that I've been at WMed, I've learned so much from the course directors and associated lecturers who pour their heart and soul into our medical education. I'm constantly grateful to have been able to work with so many dedicated, passionate, and wickedly smart clinicians who are so open to teaching us. Most of all, I'm surrounded by driven, like-minded peers who I'm happy to call my second family. And myself being a Californian pretending to be a Michigander, I am so thankful that they are my support system, and they are now yours as well. I'm also sure that by now, you know that student affairs works in our best interest and that Linda always has free candy by her desk. Pro tip, if you come early enough, sometimes she has Pringles. These and other little things have helped many, including myself, stay afloat in this endless sea of knowledge and thoughts of self-doubt. If you ever thought, wow, my classmates are so smart, and I don't feel like I belong here at any point in time, I can assure you that you're not alone, because I've been there. Honestly, I still feel that way sometimes, but as my big sib Kylie said during her speech last year, you're exactly where you're supposed to be right now. You might not have gone 100% on that IRAT, or even 100% on your summative, which, good luck, I know it's coming up. You've gone through 100% of your bad days. And one day, perhaps sooner than you think, it'll mean the world to somebody that you're here. It'll remind you why you wanted to be here in the first place. Lastly, my door is always open, and while I probably won't use my stethoscope on you, I am more than happy to listen. Thank you for listening to me today, and on behalf of the student body at WMed, welcome home. It is my honor to introduce Dr. Hal Jensen, founding dean of Western Michigan University Homer Stryker MD School of Medicine.
Thank you, Arlene. The white coat ceremony is a special rite of passage as new students begin their medical school career. Today we present to you, members of the class of 2022, with your white coat. For your clinical experiences during medical school, you will be expected to wear your white coat as part of your professional attire. Wearing the white coat is not only an expectation, but it is also a privilege and an honor. As you recite the class of 2022 medical student oath, which you of a class has composed, remember the words that you pledge today before each other, the faculty, and your family and friends. Today's ceremony is more than a ritual. You are pledging to follow this oath throughout your career as a physician. Your role as a physician has already begun as you are learning the science of medicine as well as how to practice the art of patient care. A physician must care as well as cure. As a physician, you are obligated to demonstrate excellence in the mastery and application of scientific knowledge, to be compassionate, and to embody integrity, professionalism, and lifelong learning. Our medical school faculty of more than 700 clinicians, educators, and researchers will help educate, advise, counsel, coach, mentor, and support you throughout medical school. Today, we officially welcome you into the medical profession. You will be presented with your white coat by one of your scholar advisors. As background for our guests, our medical students are organized into four learning communities that enhance learning by supporting students both with professional and social interactions among and between the classes. The scholar advisors teach clinical skills and also coach and mentor each of the medical students during their careers in medical school. Students, when a scholar advisor places the white coat on you, recognize that they represent all of the faculty who welcome you and are eager to help you become dedicated physicians, true to your oath and a credit to the medical profession. The privilege of wearing a white coat reflects the confidence that our faculty have in you that you will become competent and compassionate physicians. More importantly, the honor of a white coat, wearing a white coat, represents the trust that patients will place in you because of your competence and compassion. Throughout your career, every day, each of your small and simple actions must affirm that this confidence is well deserved and that the trust is well placed. It is now my pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker for White Coat Ceremony, Dr. Anna Hoekstra. Dr. Hoekstra grew up in Kalamazoo and completed her medical training in Chicago. She attended the University of Illinois at Chicago, where she received a master's in public health, and then attended Rush Medical School. She completed a residency in obstetrics and gynecology at Illinois Masonic Medical Center and a fellowship in gynecologic oncology at Northwestern University. After completing her training, she returned to her family and community here in Kalamazoo, where she's been at the West Michigan Cancer Center for the past 9 years. As clinical assistant professor in the department and as division chief of gynecologic oncology in the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, she has a great deal of experience and is very active in teaching medical students and residents. She's also very active in clinical research, and she's involved in the surgical robotics programs at both Bronson and Borges hospitals. It's my pleasure to welcome today's keynote speaker, Dr. Anna Hoekstra.
I would like to thank Dr. Zimkowski for the invitation to speak today and Dr. Jensen for the introduction. Good afternoon, families, friends, faculty, staff, and the WMed class of 2022. In the words of Dr. Seuss, congratulations, today is your day. You're off to great places, you're off and away. And will you succeed? Yes, you will indeed. Kid, you'll move mountains. Nobody puts it better than Dr. Seuss, the children's author, in his book entitled, Oh, the Places You'll Go. Today, I would like to share my experiences and memorable moments that shape how I strive still every day to move mountains. There are six principles I use in my approach to medicine. Hard work, balance, defining success appropriately, respect, reliance on others, and think big, think small. The first is hard work. Welcome to medical school. You've been accepted, and now you're here. Unfortunately, this doesn't entitle you to a medical degree, but represents an invitation for you to work as hard as you can for the next 4 years to earn those two little letters behind your name, MD. During my medical education, one experience stands out that put hard work into perspective. I was a medical student at Rush Medical College, which was right down the block from the old Cook County Hospital. They partnered together to educate the medical students at Rush. Cook County was the hospital for the poor and uninsured patients on Chicago's southwest side. And when I was there, they were still in the old building before building the new, more modern hospital and renaming it Stroger Hospital. So the old Cook County Hospital was a historic monument. It had a beautiful granite facade. It had human elevator operators bringing families and doctors from floor to floor. It had an operating theater with stadium seating where doctors would teach audiences of young surgeons how to operate. No longer in use when I was there. It had an open ward system where 50 or 60 patients would line a big open room separated only by hanging sheets, sharing the same sounds and the same smells. This is where I did several of my student rotations during my third year, including my emergency medicine rotation. This is where I had my memorable moment about hard work. The ER at Cook County Hospital was always bursting with patients, and there was one doc in particular who was a hustler, just running from one patient to the next. He also was dedicated to student teaching, and there were always several of us following him around from patient to patient while he was teaching us the art of diagnosis and letting us do some procedures. So as he was running to the next patient, he said something. He said, I was not born smart, like all of you young students. I had to work very hard to get through school. Now that struck me because at that time I felt like I was working pretty hard to memorize the volume of material that was being thrown at us, like you already mentioned. I didn't know if I was working harder than the other students, but at times it felt that way. To hear that encouraged me and let me know that with continued hard work, I could become the caliber of doctor this man was, working in one of the most exciting emergency departments in the country. In retrospect, I know that hard work can make up for many perceived barriers to success, whether that's your IQ, a tough personal situation, or the institutions listed on your resume. Those who move mountains work hard to do so. The second principle is balance. It's vital to care for yourself as a person while working hard as a student and physician, balancing your profession with the other interests you have as a human being. Years ago, it was expected that a physician's entire identity was wrapped up in medicine, leaving very little room for refueling, centering, and balance. Now, however, students are chosen not just for their test scores, but because of the balanced life experiences that make them unique. You all were chosen not just because you have the potential to be great doctors, but because you are great people. So when you're out of school, put work to the side and focus on your other interests, whether that's cooking, dancing, soccer, consuming literature, or whatever it is that fills your soul. The ability to have balance will also make you a more effective and focused physician. During my fellowship at Northwestern, I had a GYN oncology mentor who taught me valuable lessons about how balance will allow you to be fully present with the patients in the few minutes you have with them. Part of our job in oncology is to help patients as they near the end of their life. A conversation is usually required to assess where the patient is in her journey with cancer and how death is inescapable despite our best efforts. These conversations are often difficult for the patient and for the doctor, who together have ridden that emotional roller coaster of cancer treatment together for months or even years. Usually this conversation happens in the hospital when the patient is taking a turn for the worse. Usually the patient is in the hospital bed, laying down, and the doc and maybe the doctor's team comes in and stands by the bedside. The image I won't forget is of my mentor coming into the room for the talk and crouching down by the patient's bedside, looking her right in the eye, totally focused and present with her. For that entire 30-minute discussion, she crouched down in that position to help the patient make the most important realization of her life. That taught me something I use frequently in my practice. Get on the patient's level, look them in the eye. Be with them fully in the few minutes you have with them for a meaningful interaction. If you are distracted or exhausted, if you are depressed or overwhelmed, you will not be able to give patients what they need from you. In order to move mountains, you must have balance in your life so you may be focused, present, and at your best. The third principle is measuring success appropriately. How do we know if we're doing a good job? How I've measured success in my career has evolved. I did my fellowship at Northwestern in Chicago, which is in stark contrast to Cook County Hospital. It's a beautiful 13-story, shiny building in the heart of the Magnificent Mile. It is filled with state-of-the-art equipment and physicians with the best pedigrees. So it was there that I learned about each gynecologic cancer and how to treat it from diagnosis to remission. I learned surgical techniques, chemotherapy dosing, and palliative care. Along with that education, I memorized statistics about how curable each disease was, and if it wasn't curable, how long each patient was likely to live with their disease. These statistics were published in the best journals using the highest quality statistical methods. So with my education in hand, I moved to Kalamazoo and started using these skills. I did operations and gave chemotherapy in the right order and at the right doses. I counseled patients about these statistics so that they had some idea of what to expect. But then I also started expecting each patient to meet those statistical average numbers. Whether they were young or old, sick or healthy prior to their cancer diagnosis, whether they had social support or lived in isolation, I expected them each to meet those averages. And if they didn't, I felt like I had failed them. So I did what some of you might do when you feel low. I went home to mom and dad and shared with them my burden. I knew they would always love me despite my perceived professional failures. So my dad said something to me at that point that changed everything. He said, "Do you think what you do actually makes that much difference in whether a patient lives or dies? What you do may help patients live a little longer, but the cancer determines much of what happens to a person way before you got involved." My dad knew what I did was meaningful, and he knew about all the patients that I did help, but he helped me see a vital point. The treatability of some patients and some diseases is beyond our control. If it is meant to be cured, our modern medical approaches will cure it. But if it is aggressive or poorly understood, even the best and brightest among us are unlikely to cure them. Of course, we should all work to make advances in medical diagnosis and treatment. We should all strive to help patients live as long as possible with the highest possible quality of life. Those are the givens. But it's not a failure of your character if you don't cure every patient of what ails them. It's important as you guys grow in your specialties to know what you can control and what you can't. Don't measure success in ways that lead to frustration, guilt, and feelings of failure. Sometimes you can't move the mountain, and that's okay. The fourth principle is respect. Caring for one another with love and respect is the reason many of us chose medicine and will dedicate our lives to it. developing a respectful relationship with those who are the same as us or different than us, those who have insurance, those who don't, those who are healthy, and those who are bedridden. Mother Teresa, who spent a lifetime caring for the poor and forgotten, said, "Love one another. Let us always meet each other with a smile, for the smile is the beginning of love." Each patient encounter is an opportunity to smile and nourish a respectful relationship. Two physician authors have provided me mentorship about respecting patients in their writing. Dr. Jerome Gropman is a hematology-oncology doc and chair of medicine at Harvard Medical School. He wrote a book called The Anatomy of Hope, in which he taught me that respecting patients means communicating with direct, honest, yet compassionate ways. He writes about how communicating directly to patients will allow them to understand the full extent of their disease. And if appropriate, this should be followed by giving them appropriate hope that will energize them to fight against that disease. He taught me that sugarcoating a patient's prognosis can give them false hope, leaving them and their family unprepared for the end of their life. On the other hand, presenting only dismal statistics and a bleak prognosis may take away all hope. Hopelessness would prevent them from enjoying the rest of their life or accepting treatment to prolong it. Dr. Gropman's mentorship helped me understand the role of hope in respecting patients. My second author mentor is Dr. Atul Gawande. Maybe he's yours too. He's a general surgeon, among other things, at Brigham and Women's Hospital in Boston. He's written a variety of books, and one of them is called Being Mortal, which examines the evolution of our culture's approach to aging. Dr. Gawande writes about how we as healthcare providers can respect patients by maximizing their autonomy at the end of their life. Historically, we have minimized a patient's autonomy in favor of honoring the goals of either the physician or the patient's family. The physician sometimes may be programmed to extend life as long as possible, and the patient's family may be thinking most about how the patient could be safest or most easily managed. The alternative Dr. Gawande offers us is to prioritize the goals of the patient and figure out what makes them happy. Asking questions like, what do you live for? Where do you prefer to spend your time? Do you prioritize quantity or quality of life? Dr. Gawande's mentorship helped me understand the role of autonomy in respecting patients. All these mentors teach me about the foundation of respect for patients. Start with a smile, give them appropriate hope, listen to what is important to them, and help them achieve their goals. This makes moving mountains meaningful. The fifth principle is reliance on others. None of us can do this alone, and none of us are alone. It's very clear to me that a number of people and scholarship funds were necessary for me to become a doctor. Many of us have the support of families, friends, or significant others. Some of you don't, and you still got here. There may be a tendency towards self-reliance at points in your career due to competitiveness, arrogance, or spite. Please resist that, as medical education and this entire career path are way too hard to do on our own. Of all the people in my life on whom I relied, one is directly responsible for my career path, and his name is Dr. John Lorraine. He's a GYN oncologist at Northwestern. I first met Dr. Lorraine when I was a fourth-year medical student. I was trying to decide between going into family medicine or obstetrics and gynecology. My heart was always in women's reproductive health care, but I didn't know if I was prepared to commit to the grueling lifestyle that represented OBGYN at that time. This was before balanced lifestyles and resident work hour restrictions. So I went to Northwestern to help me figure that out. So I met Dr. Lorraine. He was a tough senior faculty, revered by all who met him. It was partly out of fear, because he occasionally raised his voice or threw an instrument across the operating room to make sure he wasn't misunderstood. But he was also revered for his surgical skill and his excellent patient care. He also prioritized medical education, so he built the program in Northwestern around the education of students and residents. He was the guy who could make or break your chances at a residency with a good or bad letter of recommendation. So naturally, all the students were fighting over the chance to rotate with him. So I got my rotation, spent a month with him, and I learned a lot. He yelled me through my first real skin incision on a patient, and by the end of the month, I had seen the softer side of him that made everyone so loyal to him. At the end of the month, I did decide that I wanted to go into obstetrics and gynecology, and I entered my residency program. Throughout the first several years of my residency, I did projects with Dr. Lorraine, and my interest in specializing in GYN and oncology grew. By the time my third year rolled around, it was time to start looking at programs, and I got a call from Dr. Lorraine saying that he was starting a new fellowship program at Northwestern that previously didn't exist. He encouraged me to apply and then ended up accepting me in his second class of fellows. I know without a doubt I owe my career to this man. And at age 72, he's still practicing full-time at Northwestern, considering a reduced schedule, and anyone would be lucky to train with him. I could not and would not have done it on my own. And people you meet along the way will help you get to where you're meant to be. Let them help you, and in return, help people who come behind you. Nobody can move mountains alone. The last principle before I wrap up is think big, think small. One thing you may find when you're navigating through your career is that there are opportunities to move big mountains and small ones. And both are meaningful. Every day on my way to and from work, I listen to the local national public radio station. And a few months back, I heard a story about the Secretary of the Health Department in Louisiana, Dr. Rebecca Gee. She decided to eradicate hepatitis C in her state. Hepatitis C is one of the diseases that leads to liver failure, cirrhosis, and liver cancer. Liver cancer is on the rise in our country, while the rates of many other cancers are going down. There is a new treatment for hepatitis C that has worked better than anything else previously on the market in just 12 weeks. The only barrier to this treatment is its high cost. Dr. Gee was being faced with ethical issues about who is entitled to be treated with this new drug. In Louisiana, there are 20,000 Medicaid patients with hepatitis C, and last year only 388 of them were treated. So she was considering which health education programs she needed to cut or which medical benefits she would remove in order to pay for more drug. So she thought outside the box. She proposed a deal to the drug company where the state would pay the drug company a fixed price over a certain number of years. During that time, the drug company would provide all the drug necessary to treat all the hepatitis C patients, and that number would decline significantly over time. In the end, it was a wash. Both parties were satisfied, and at the time of the report, a final deal had not been struck, but both parties were optimistic. Dr. Gee chose a role in medicine where she thinks big and is a public health inspiration. Her ability to navigate a complex healthcare system with non-traditional ideas will have a positive impact on the lives of many people. Some of you out there have or will get a degree in public health, or you'll enter into an administrative role where you will change systems, thinking big. Most of us, however, will focus on improving the lives of individual patients, thinking small. I chose a surgical field, taking out one tumor at a time. For each individual patient, the doctor that removes their tumor fixes their blood pressure, or puts a cast on their child's broken arm, that's the most important doctor in their life. Whether you think big or think small, you will make a difference in people's lives. In conclusion, I'll return again to the words of Dr. Seuss. Today is your day. Your mountain is waiting, so get on your way. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Hoekstra. Before we begin the presentation of White Coats, I would like to acknowledge the White Coat sponsors. The White Coat sponsorship program is an opportunity to engage the community as we welcome our new medical students and they embark on the path to becoming a physician. A White Coat sponsor provided a financial contribution that funded a White Coat, stethoscope, as you heard, tuning forks, reflex hammer, and a set of scrubs for each student. In addition, each sponsor wrote a note of encouragement for the student, and that note has been placed in the pocket of each student's white coat. Earlier this week, students had the opportunity to meet their white coat sponsor. Thank you to our white coat sponsors for your support and commitment to our medical students. Thank you. Round of applause. We will now begin the cloaking ceremony. Cloaking will be done by learning community, and each student will be introduced as they receive their white coat. You're welcome to applaud and cheer, but thank you for allowing each student's name to be heard between your applause. So, from Learning Community APGAR, Scholar Advisor, Dr. Kathy Sharon. Sarah Jo Chalberg. Sean Cody. Nikki Coleman. Jack Dewey. Khadija Hussein. Henry Lent. Winnie Long. Andrew Lynch. Ernest Morton. Jean Ord. Sonia Parikh. Also from Learning Community APGAR, Scholar Advisor, Dr. Priscilla Woodhams. Natalie Finazzo. Patrick Hilaire. David Juan. Aditya Mehta. Daniel Michelli. Anne O'Neill. Fahad Salman. Megan Sandberg. Kelsey Schultz. Saurabh Singhal. Next is Learning Community Blackwell, Scholar Advisor, Dr. Sandra Wiederhold. Adrienne Ardema. Abdul Elmunajid. Alex Santala. Catherine Chen. Monica Chi. John Frederick. Ricardo Kempfin. Auburn Skakel. Letty Thoughtafil. Allison Zhang. Also from Learning Community Blackwell is Scholar Advisor Dr. Diane Pierce. Keenan Bulnamore. Rachel Chang. Matthew Gray. Sophia He. Anna John. Dashmeet Maharaj. Jacob Poliski. Sarah Smith. Gabriel Talent. Paul Youssef. And Sabrina Zahouri. From Learning Community Cushing, Scholar Advisor, Dr. Robert Reinhardt. Caroline Buckley. Mark Canner. Paul Dudek. Gabrielle Duchovny. Lisa Gustafson. Vishal Jadhav. Stephen Jones. Jacob Lautzi. Janelle Lee. Gordon Liu. Maria Magidenko. Annika Newler. Elaine Oldford. Dustin Rowland. Madeline Sebastian. Harrison Seltzer. Matthew Sierra. Rachel Tomasi. Spencer Weckworth. And Jeffrey Wood. And finally, Learning Community Drew, Scholar Advisor, Dr. Ross Driscoll. Ray Bear. Brett Dempsey. Yoon Im. Michael Malky. Rebecca Reardon. Gina Shoemaker. Jack Stover. Also from Learning Community Drew, Scholar Advisor Dr. Theo Gomes. Daniel Emmerich. Casey Felco. Davis Giroux. Natasha Harris. Melissa Pellman. Devin Terraciano. Waits out. Also from Learning Community Drew, Scholar Advisor Dr. Brandy Shattuck. Apoorva Dharmadhikari. Jordan Jobara. Nicole Lee. Drew Moss. Kelsey Suggs. Robert Welch. Rachel Wallach. To lead today's oath, I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Cheryl Dixon, Associate Dean for Health Equity and Community Affairs.
What a wonderful day. Thank you, Dr. Zinkowski. As he mentioned earlier, in addition to the white coat, the medical oath of Hippocrates is another symbol of the medical profession. The Oath of Hippocrates is the most widely known of the Greek medical texts. The oath requires a new physician to swear upon the healing gods that he or she will uphold professional ethical standards. Over the centuries, it has been rewritten, often in order to suit the values of different cultures. A medical oath declares the ethos of medicine. An oath includes solemn promises that identify the covenant that exists between physicians and their patients. I had the opportunity, in conjunction with my colleagues, Dr. Michael Redinger and Dr. Tyler Gibb, to work with the students to compose the WMed Class of 2022 Medical Student Oath that will be recited today. The composition of the class oath has traditionally been a student learning project, and that has enabled students to work together within their learning communities to create their oath that they will abide by through their 4 years. I would like to at this time acknowledge the work of the student representatives from each learning community for their leadership and teamwork in putting together the oath for their class. They are Khadija Hussein, could you stand? Khadija, can you stand? Sorry. Jean Ord. Andrew Lynch. Auburn Skakel. Sierra Smith. Harrison Seltzer. Kelsey Suggs. And Nicole Lee. Give these students a hand. Thank you for your leadership. Creation of their own class oath enabled the students to reflect on the principles that they feel are important to embrace as medical professionals. The entire class was involved in finalizing their oath and approving this content. You will find a copy of the oath in your handbook and your today's program. At this time, I'm going to ask the class of 2022 to stand and recite your oath. It is my honor to present to you the newest members of our medical community, the WMed class of 2022. I'd like to have Dr. Simkowski come back to the stage.
Once again, thank you for joining us for the WMed Class of 2022 White Coat Ceremony. We'd like to thank the Arnold P. Gold Foundation for the Humanism in Medicine pins affixed to each white coat. Thank you all for coming today, and please join us on the W.E. Umpjohn campus for a reception. Directions can be found in your program. Members of the class of 2022 will be taking class photos as you exit the auditorium and will join you soon for the reception. Thank you.